Well, good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. With that said, we welcome you and those that are also watching by screen. Just let you know, today we're looking at the Lord will renew their strength. And so we'll hear that in our sermon today, as well as in our hymns and also in our liturgy. And so with that said, may the Lord strengthen our work and our strength together. Let's rise and greet those around us with a hand of fellowship and welcome. Opening hymn entitled, Praise the Lord the Almighty. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Mighty and merciful Lord, with heavy hearts we confess our sin to you. Almighty God, captive to sin, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Our fear has kept us from hearing and responding to your call. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Our speaking of the gospel has sometimes lacked clarity and passion. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Our fears have revealed the lesser gods we pursue. Bring to us repentance, Lord. Forgive our sins, those of which we are aware and those we do unwittingly. Have mercy on us. Seek us, for you alone can find us and restore us. Jesus said, "Do you not be afraid? For now on you will be catching men. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you of all your sins. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen." You may be seated. All right, so, I'm sorry, I was going to do children's sermon first. I'm so sorry. I won't make you get up, Scott, but hey, how many of you have a cell phone like this? Or have something that you need to plug in, right? We plug things in because sooner or later, what happens? It dies, right? The battery goes out and all of a sudden, we find ourselves without power, right? But how do we get power? We plug into the outlet, right? And then we plug into the phone or to the electronics and all of a sudden the battery gets recharged. So here's a question for you. When we lose our power, when we feel lonely or we feel struggling or we feel unhappy, how do we connect to God? Praying, okay. Yeah, right. Or his word, right? His word, the word of God gives us power, right? Recharges us and gives us strength. And you know, if we're away from the word, what happens? Sooner or later we die, right? Energy-wise or even faith-wise, we can begin to fade. And so the Lord wants us to be empowered with him. And so if we even look in our Bible verse about being renewed in the Lord, you know, he gives us his strength to endure what we face, right? And so that's something to remember. Today we're enduring and we're renewing our strength in the word of the Lord. And so that's true. And then our response to that is prayer and all those things that we have by faith. So with that said, we invite you to read along with our scripture lesson.
Jerusalem, its people and its rulers were being threatened. The Lord spoke through Isaiah to remind them who he is, the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. They were to wait for the Lord, and they would find that, in his strength, they would mount up with wings like eagles. It's strong encouragement also for us to wait for the Lord. Isaiah chapter 40. Do you not know? Do you not hear? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to dwell in, who brings princes to nothing and makes the rulers of the earth as emptiness. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows on them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me that I should be like him, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host by number, calling them by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, no one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths fall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In his sense of responsibility as an apostle of Jesus, Paul saw himself as a slave to all, meeting them where they were in their life, so he might, through his preaching of the gospel, win some. We too need to meet people with the gospel where they are and not expect everyone to be like us. 1 Corinthians 9:16 through 27. For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am still entrusted with a stewardship. What then is my reward? That in my preaching I may present the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel. For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as one beating the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. This is the word of the Lord.
We rise for the singing. Hallelujah. Have the words of eternal life. Hallelujah. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. Jesus' loving compassion for people in need was a driving force of his ministry. As we hear about it, we are encouraged to bring our sick and troubled to him in prayer. He cares and will and can and will help. Mark describes Jesus' compassion ministry already in his first chapter. And immediately he left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew. With James and John, now Simon's mother-in-law lay ill with a fever, and immediately they told him about her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick and oppressed by demons. And the whole city was gathered together at the door. And he healed many who were sick with various diseases, cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. And rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. Simon and those who were with him searched for him, and they found him and said to him, "Everyone is looking for you." And he said to them, "Let us go on to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out." And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in the synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. We sing a hymn entitled, "On Eagle's Wings." Welcome you to this morning. If you look at the front of our bulletin, you'll actually see the text verse that we're using today. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Amen. Let's pray. We pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord. May we be renewed in our lives when there is struggle and suffering and hardship. May we find in you the strength to be renewed. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I had received a phone call from a modern-day daughter of Job. A woman in my first congregation had called me because her life had been torn apart by her husband's failing. No, he didn't fail morally, but he had an overinflated ego and decided that he could help his business without his boss's permission. He decided to throw out one vendor's software for another. In turn, he was fired from his job, a job that paid some $150,000, and now his family was suffering. And even worse than that, he lost his income, his home, and his wife was questioning the relationship that she had with her husband. Forced to move in with the mother-in-law, and there she struggled and suffered. She wondered, why was this the outcome of her life? Bewildered and deliberating whether her life should go on with her husband or not, she began to find it difficult, especially as she was beginning to become disappointed with God. You see, she had always found verse Isaiah 40:43 encouraging for people. She had put her hope in the Lord. She believed that in all the wonderful things that God spoke in Isaiah 40 was for her. She saw him as a gentle shepherd who gathered his lambs in his arms. He is the mighty creator of the universe. She really recognized that he directed all the things in life. And now she struggled. She genuinely believed that God was alive, and she trusted in him. But in her troubles, Mary began to put her hope not in the Lord, but in the problems that she experienced. It hadn't worked out in what she expected, and she became disappointed in who God was. Perhaps you have experienced the same feelings that Mary had. As we read Isaiah 40, it is very clear that ancient Israel as well, too, were disappointed in God as well, too. Verse 25 of Isaiah 40, we hear the voices of disappointment when people cry out, "My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by God." Their lives had been torn apart. The Babylonian captivity had taken place, and God's special covenant people were now imprisoned. But more than that, they were sent into exile. They lost their nation. They lost their status in the world. They lost their homeland. They lost their temple. And they felt that they were forsaken by God. Oh, that he had promises The word of God promised that they would return one day, but they must have wondered, where is God in all of this? Can we believe these words? They were disappointed, and again they kept on saying, my ways are hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded. C.S. Lewis once experienced this in his own life, his disappointment in God. It's important to recognize that C.S. Lewis is a key figure. And like Israel and like even Mary in the opening of this sermon, both of them expected different things from God, and when the outcome didn't happen, there was a disappointment. C.S. Lewis, you may recall, in his life, he started as an agnostic. He didn't believe in God. And to some surprise, through a friend's conversation, he became a believer. And not just a believer, he became a defender of the great faith that we hold. He would publish books, and millions of people would be strengthened in their belief in Jesus Christ. Lewis was particularly eloquent in the problem of pain. If you've seen the movie The Shadowlands, you can hear him saying, pain is God's megaphone to us. You see, Lewis was a true believer who assisted many in suffering. And like Mary, he found himself in his own shadowland, in his own valley and disappointment. You see, later in life, C.S. Lewis had fallen in love with a woman by the name of Joy. In their 60s, they came to be intimately in love with each other. Both of them single for a long time. Lewis never married, had experienced this love with intensity at the end of his life. And yet, Joy was struck with cancer. C.S. Lewis pleaded to God that he would remove this cancer. But Lewis was shattered by the fact of his grief that his wife did die of cancer. In his own book called Grief Observed, he talks about the disappointment with God. God is our refuge and strength, he says, a very present help in trouble. I prayed for the love of his life, but God had not presented help. In spite of his prayers, she died. Lewis, in his book, asks that God, what can we reasonably expect from God when we're in trouble? Sometimes it's important for us to recognize that our understanding of God is the disappointment, not in God and who he is, but in our thinking of putting God in a certain box. Sometimes we misunderstand who God is. Long ago, I remember a sermon in the seminary when a professor spoke those familiar words. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. I think these words capture very much what we expect from God. First, we will soar like wings of eagles. God simply sometimes rescues us quickly. I think we many times are disappointed with God because we expect that in every moment he will instantly rescue us. But that's not always how God works. Yes, God sometimes miraculously changes situations and brings out quick results. On wings of eagles, our trouble is gone. I can remember reading a story about a young boy who fell into an icy lake. In a faraway place, they screamed out loud, and for some a miracle, a stranger was walking by who was well equipped to save them, pulled them from the icy lake, and they were miraculously saved. They said, God saved us in this situation. It's like that in the parable of the healing of the 10 lepers. There, Jesus is walking along and heals the 10 lepers as they go to show themselves to the Pharisees. But that's not always how God rescues us. Sometimes the Lord rescues us from our troubles, but that's not always how God responds. Sometimes God helps not by rescuing us from our situations, but by running alongside with us in the situations together that he can help us repair. See, the power works with us so that we can run and not grow weary. We don't think that we can keep on going sometimes. We don't think that we have the power, but with his strength and his help and his guidance and his presence, we can find that we find strength. We have strength to run because he is there along with us. Mary found this out later after the situations in her life. After her husband's failings, she found strength in renewing her relationship by recognizing that God doesn't always rescue us from our troubles. Sometimes he helps us in our situations. Because God gives us strength in the situation, we can run through them. Think of the way that God fixes the problems in Israel. When Israel was in captivity in Egypt for 400 years, God didn't just quickly deliver them from their troubles. Instead, he was with them through those years, and he finally provided Moses to be with them. With God's help and with God's strength, Moses ran and didn't grow weary. The situation was changed. But there are other times when God helps us, not by changing the situation, not by rescuing us from our trouble or our problems, but instead by changing us. The situations don't change, but we do. We grow stronger and we don't faint. We think we will, but we don't. I will tell you, as a personal confession, I don't like the idea that God changes us. I would rather have him remove us from the situation in life. We find that with the Apostle Paul, don't we? When the Apostle Paul, in his second letter to the Corinthians, prayed that the thorn in his flesh, the trouble of his life, would be removed. Paul described that he begged to God three times to take this affliction away from him. And yet, he heard the plea. The Lord didn't take it away. Instead, God said, "My grace is sufficient for you to endure, my power made perfect in weakness." Although the Apostle Paul was afflicted, God had greater things in mind for him. He would use that to change the world, and the Apostle Paul would write these words: "For Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, insult, and in hardship, in persecution, in difficulty. For when I am weak, then I am strong." I think we need to hear those words that the Apostle Paul writes, "For Christ's sake. I really want to be rescued from my own troubles. I want to soar like the eagles. I want no problems." Notice it's the I. That's how God rescues us and how he helps those who hope in him. He may rescue us from the situation by miraculous interventions. He may repair the situations in life as we walk with him through them. He may change us to endure our own struggles and give us strength. I'd like to go back to those words, "for Christ's sake." It's not about us, but it's about Christ. The sobering reality reminds us that the great saving reality of Christ was about all of us. He rose from the dead for our sake, and we can expect that God will be with us at times when we struggle. Whether it takes the form of rescue or repair or even renewal of our souls, we can expect that God to keep on doing what he's always done, to save us for the utter sake of Christ. If we keep our eyes focused on the Son of God dying and rising for our sake, we will not be disappointed with God. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar up on wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not be faint. May the peace of God give you this strength. Amen. Today we skip our creed and we will We will open with our prayers. We rise to pray. Today, we want to pray for those listed in our bulletin. We also want to pray for those that have been affected by dangerous weather throughout our state. Let us pray. God of heaven, we come before you. In many ways, you renew us and strengthen us when we're weak. Give to us eyes to see your work in our life and sustain us through those times of despair, Lord. Help us to overcome faithlessness and also doubt. Lord, in your mercy, Father, we thank you for the blessings that you give to us in your word. When we are weak and we are without strength, we look to your word for strength and strengthen us in that word this day. May we find hope and bring those words of hope to people who are struggling. We pray, Lord, for this world and the people that have not yet known you as their Lord and Savior. We ask that the work of many of your people would bring the word of God to many hearts. We pray for the work of our church and for the work of churches in our community to bring your love and knowledge of you. We pray, Lord, for pastors and teachers. We pray for parents who raise their children in the Christian faith and for grandparents as well who witness the love of Christ to their grandchildren, great-grandchildren. We ask that you would renew and strengthen us. Above all, Lord, we pray that you would also keep this nation and the nations of the world from going to war. May leaders work toward peace instead of destruction. We pray, Lord, also for those that come to our aid, police and firefighters, for teachers and doctors and nurses, and all those that care for our community. We pray, Lord, for them and their work, that they may fulfill their oath and serve others. We pray, Lord, also for those listed in our bulletins who are sick. We pray especially, Lord, that you would be with those that have lost loved ones in this last month. We pray, Lord, also for the renewing of our families, that you would strengthen marriages and those that have been united in marriage. We pray for marriages that struggle through choices of individuals who hurt spouses. We pray for families where there is strife and difficulty, where there are families broken over inheritances and other financial problems. We ask all of these things, Lord. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we will take our offerings and our tithes to the Lord. Would you please fill out the friendship roster in your pew? If there's a change of address, email, or address, please indicate that. And if you have any concerns or needs as well, please indicate those if you'd like a visit from the UK. with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and proper that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, and everlasting God. As your children, you have given us a perfect love to see your Son, Jesus Christ, in his humble birth, perfect life, sacrificial death, and glorious resurrection, by which you give us the forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Holy, holy, holy Lord God Almighty, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And also, in the same way, he took the cup, and when he supped. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We sing.
Thank you.
sing in thanksgiving for these gifts which God has given. Almighty Father, your patience toward us is great, and your love is without limit. Grant to us grace that we, by the forgiveness of our sins, be kept holy and pure to the day of Christ's coming again, when we shall stand before the judgment seat on high. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Our sending song, Fight the Good Fight. I have a letter that I'd like to read to you today from Ginger Schneider, our preschool director. Dear Trinity Lutheran Congregation, this past November we celebrate our 20-year anniversary at Trinity Child Development Center, and I'm so proud of the accomplishments that the children's lives who have been touched over this last 20 years. I cherish the guidance and friendship I've received over the years from Trinity Congregation, the congregational presidents, and the TCDC board members. I learned so much over these years from everyone's knowledge and wisdom. Lastly, but most important of all, is my Trinity staff. We would not be who we are and without the exceptional caregivers we've had over many years. Many have served us for 10 to 19 years and are still with us. With joy and heartfelt sadness, I am announcing my retirement from Trinity Child Development Center. I'm so thankful to the congregation for hiring me as the director of the new Trinity Child Development Center in February of 2003. My mother told me at the time that it was an honor and a divine invitation to be working for the church. This was so true and a pleasure to be a part of the Trinity Lutheran Church family. I truly gave my heart and soul to this church mission. Rex, Autumn, Spencer were so supportive upon acceptance of my new job at Trinity. We joined the church and Rex went to work immediately, putting furniture together for classrooms, set up, and helping wherever he was needed. It was a true blessing when Autumn joined our Trinity Child Development Center family in June of 2015. We will begin the search for my replacement in the coming weeks, and I'm planning my last days will be in May. Blessings to you all and our families. Ginger Schneider, Child Development Center. Let's give her a round of applause. I know she's not here, but... And so we'll begin that process of looking for someone who's blessed to serve our church and its mission and all of that stuff. So just wanted to read that to you. And it will be read at the voters meeting and also the next service. So again, thank you all for being here today. Again, our Bible study that we've been studying is the church and its mission. And today we're looking at the idea of we are the church. And what does that mean? Or I am a member of the church, or I am the church. And so we want to invite you to be part of that. So please stay for that if you're able to. Again, thank you all for being here. And if there's anybody that you haven't seen in a while or missing, please reach out to them. Or if you see them around or in public life, worship, in the neighborhood or even in the store, tell them, hey, your church family misses you. So with that said, have a wonderful day.